work on the show accompanying it didn't really make a whole lot of sense to me. There are two other articles I'm going to discuss today. One of them is there's a famous film editor named Walter Murch, who is probably most famous for Cutting Apocalypse Now and a number of other films that you know, Cold Mountain and whatever. He's cut a million movies. He's written two books. One is called In the Blink of an Eye, which is a book about editing. And then the second book, which I find personally a lot more interesting, is called Conversations, which is a book that he did with the novelist Michael Ondaatje. And it's a series of conversations between this novelist and film editor talking about film. And I'll talk a little bit about from that essay. I brought a copy of that essay. I only have a paper copy of it. And I'm going to read like a page out of it. If you find that you're interested in it, I'm happy to give it to someone. You can copy it. The other thing that I'm going to reference and read a bit of is the opening, it's called the prologue to the book on the Saadian Woman, The Ideology of Pornography by Angela Carter, which I again have the full introduction. It's about a 30-page introduction. I'm not going to read the whole thing here, but if people are inclined to want to take a copy of that away, which I personally find to be an incredibly fascinating, really useful article, I'm happy to share. So we can copy and distribute the rest of that stuff that way if you want. So what I want to do is sort of wrap up the talking about the activist work from the morning and then move on. And from there, I think really what I intended to do in the morning is just to create a kind of foundation to talk about the rest of the work that I've done here. And also in some ways it's a provocation to you all to say, collective action is an incredibly powerful, important thing. It's still possible in the culture we live in, and many of the tactics and strategies we use within Gran Fury are still, I think, very applicable. One thing I wanted to just reference that I didn't show this morning, but I think bears discussing a little bit, is that within the context of representation on HIV and AIDS, there's a very large body of work of portraiture that was done of people with HIV and AIDS in the early period of AIDS, particularly from, thank you, nice crocodiles. there's a photographer named Nicholas Nixon, who had a show at the Museum of Modern Art in the late 1980s. And he comes out of a very straight, traditional documentary school of photography, where he took photographs of people with AIDS, intending to use those photographs as a kind of activist challenge. They're problematic images in a lot of ways, because all they do is reflect back images of suffering and wasting and death, and there's nothing. And for those of us who are involved in kind of direct action activism at the time, we had almost no patience for that work at all. Not that we thought it was unimportant to represent people with AIDS, but rather, what did you get out of the idea of recording that kind of imagery? So I was thinking a lot about this, and I read again before I came here the book by Susan Sontag called Regarding the Pain of Others. And I just want to read a couple little clips from the Sontag book, which is talking basically about the notion of war photography and the relationship of photographing trauma in the culture we're in. And it's interesting to me how corollary, how relevant many of the things that Susan Sontag is writing about in this book are to the actual idea of representing any person who has an illness or any person who's struggling with health. She writes, and I'm just going to excerpt a number of places. She writes, photographs of the victims of wars are themselves a species of rhetoric. They reiterate, they simplify, they agitate, they create the illusion of consensus. To an Israeli Jew, a photograph of a child torn apart in the attack on the Sabaro Pizzeria in downtown Jerusalem is first of all a photograph of a Jewish child killed by a Palestinian suicide bomber. To a Palestinian, a photo of a child torn apart by a tank ground in Gaza is first of all a photograph of a Palestinian child killed by Israeli ordnance. To the militant, identity is everything. And all photographs want weight to be explained or falsified by their captions. During the fighting between the Serbs and the Croats in the Balkan Wars, the same photographs of children killed in the shelling of a village were passed around at both Serb and Croat propaganda briefings. Alter the caption, and the children's death could be used and reused. And then she goes on to talk about, and I think this is really interesting in terms of just thinking about the cultural place we are now, about the representation of trauma and war. In 1899, Gustave Moynier, the first president of the International Committee of the Red Cross, wrote, quote, "We now know what happens every day throughout the whole world. The descriptions given by daily journalists put, as it were, those in agony on fields of battle under the eyes of newspaper readers, and their cries resonate in our ears." This is, I think, interesting, the late 19th century, the kind of you know, prevalence of reporting even at that time, the notion that people were seeing the stuff right from the battle lines and sort of being reproduced very quickly. And if you think now how rapidly the reportage of war is, its acceleration is remarkable. And then she goes on to write, awareness of the suffering that accumulates in a select number of wars happening elsewhere is something constructed, principally in the form that is registered by cameras. It flares up, is shared by many people, and fades from view. In contrast to a written account, which, depending on the complexity of thought, reference, and vocabulary, is pitched to the larger or smaller readership, a photograph has only one language and is destined potentially for all. The Spanish Civil War was the first war to be witnessed, quote, covered in the modern sense, 1936 to 1939, by a corps of professional photographers at the lines of military engagement in the towns under bombardment, whose work was immediately seen in newspapers and magazines in Spain and abroad. The war America waged in Vietnam, the first to be witnessed day after day by television cameras, introduced the home front to new tele-intimacy with death and destruction. Ever since, battles and massacres filmed as they unfold have been a routine ingredient of the ceaseless flow of domestic small-screen entertainment. I think what's particularly relevant about this, and for me at least thinking about this, is the notion of what she says, in contrast to a written account, which depending on the complexity of thought, reference, and vocabulary, is pitched to the larger or smaller readership, a photograph only has one language. This notion of that Gran Fury used photography as one of the elements that we were working within, but the idea of a kind of intertextual approach, not relying just on reportage, to kind of put forward what we were doing, seemed a much more powerful, much more complex way to address an audience. Rather, and really in a lot of ways, it's still my objection to the idea of just merely reproducing or photographing the victims of any illness or victims of any war, because it replicates and reiterates that position, kind of flattens that position and inscribes that position by reproducing the photograph. And the more you see those photographs, the more they either replicate that kind of line of decision or can be used and manipulated in all kinds of ways to apply other meaning. So I think that sounds like, I think that book, if you're not, I assume most of you are aware of that book, that Regarding the Pain of Others, I think it's a very useful text to look at and think about in terms of the relationship of war reportage and crisis journalism in the 20th and 21st century, in relationship to its roots back in the 19th century. The two remaining things I want to show and talk about around HIV and AIDS are, first of all, the DVD of the four shorts of Kissing Doesn't Kill. So Gran Fury produced at the same time we produced the bus shelter, the poster, and the rest of it, we made four 30-second public service announcements. Public service announcements are not so common these days. Perhaps you remember the very famous one that was, this is your brain, this is your brain on drugs, with the frying egg in the egg pan, which is an amazing, priceless commercial. Public service announcements are meant to be, most broadcast networks reserve a small percentage of their broadcast airspace to broadcast these public service announcements that are supposed to be giving health information or other kind of socially conscious information to the audience. When we produced these, there were two contexts that they were going to appear in. One was in a national public service announcement campaign to be randomly slotted on the networks at any time during the day. And then the second was in a very targeted use, which was, in the late 80s and early 90s, there were a series of CDs, a series of recordings put out called Red Hot and, so it's Red Hot Blue, Red Hot and Jazz, and they were all AIDS fundraisers, where different artists came together and recorded, you know, jazz tunes or rap tunes or whatever, and that they were making into compilation CDs. There were music videos that were made of these shorts, and so on ABC, there was a nightly, for the first time, Red Hot and Blue, they did this hour and a half long special event where they were going to show all these short films made from it. Shockingly, amazingly, ABC rejected these 30-second spots because they had same-sex controversy. This is, again, I think one of the things that's just really extraordinary and important, I think, to remember representationally and the rest of it, for all of the kind of culture that we're in, for all, you know, when you think of particularly the cable networks in the United States, HBO and Showtime particularly, and the levels of representational outrageousness. You know, we have pop-dealing mothers, we have, you know, nymphomaniac housewives, we have, you know, same-sex couples who are teenagers and these television shows. This was unthinkable, actually, in a time not even really that long ago, 1990. And that's what I think is so funny about these pieces is though we put a lot of sort of production resources into making them, they were virtually not seen at all, actually, because in the end, the public service announcement campaign didn't run them because they were considered too shocking, too outrageous, and the Red Hot and Blue campaign rejected them as well. I think it's fun to set them up in that way, because now, when I show them, in this video, a number of members of Gran Fury are in this video. I'm actually in this video. But I think what's really interesting is David Vomarovich, whose work I show, is one of the couples kissing in this video, and there's a visual artist named Zoe Leonard, who's a fairly well-known photographer in the art world in New York City, who's also a person in this. It's a kind of incredible day. We set up a shooting day where we just invited all these people that we knew and said, come and kiss, basically. And so people came who were couples kissing, but then all kinds of other people kissed as well. So it's a kissing extravaganza.
They're not at all the sort of nefarious and shocking material that is made up to you by the networks.
So the second piece I want to show is a piece that I directed myself. This is probably the first piece of short work I made that had any real prominence. It's a videotape from 1989. It's 13 minutes long. It's called They Are Lost to Vision Altogether. Just to give you a little context about it, one of the movements that sort of has drifted from focus, and turn the light back on, since I don't know how to do it, fantastic, we can see each other. One of the movements that sort of drifted from attention but was very prominent in the 80s was a movement in video called Scratch Video. Scratch Video takes its roots in hip-hop, actually, which is just like scratching and turntablist idea of sampling, fracturing, combining different elements together. And so Scratch Video, the practical application of it in the 80s was that people used found appropriated source material and recut it into other contexts. So all of my initial early video work was constructed in this way. I shot nothing. So probably from 1985 to 1989, I virtually shot none of my own footage and was making and recontextualizing meaning from pop culture and making short work. Not really that's where the resemblance to hip hop ends. In other words, the content didn't overlap with hip hop. It wasn't urban, it wasn't, wasn't focused on the themes and stories of hip hop, but the strategies and techniques of appropriation, layering, and juxtaposition were central. This piece is a kind of transition out of Scratch Video for me, which is probably a third of the material in this piece you'll see, you'll recognize as appropriated footage, and then the remaining two-thirds of the material is material I shot myself. And when tonight I present, I'm going to show two new short experimental work, and through the rest of this few days, I'm going to show a variety of experimental work. And you can see, I think, within my own work, a kind of trajectory of beginning in, and it really shows my roots, I think, as an artist in terms of my references of the picture generation and this idea of appropriated work and work that's talking about popular culture by appropriating imagery and a movement away from it. So, and what I find interesting now is in the most recent experimental work I've done, I'm starting to appropriate work again, which I find interesting. I don't have any rules in my work anymore. I'm wondering, this is interesting. I'm using found footage, and the context of using the found footage is somewhat different. So it's sort of an interesting progression. That'd be easier.
This is my funeral service. We have no ceremonies, only private dirges and no conclusions, only violent sensations, each separate.
You said I shouldn't, but that behavior of academia proficiency seems to be uniformly fatal. In Atlanta, Georgia.
I had so much trouble with this line. I love you forever.
Homosexual males, Haitians, drug abusers, and those who may have received blood products. Research to find a cure for AIDS has resulted in the isolation of a virus. In the United States, it's called HTLV-3. In France, it's known as LAV.
Thank you. philosophy and how to control that sexual drive.
In Cuba, every man, woman, and child over the age of 15 is tested for the AIDS virus. Those who test positive are asked to go voluntarily to an isolation facility. Those who refuse are brought in by force.
Meanwhile, let us abolish the ticking of time's clock with one blow. Come closer.
American AIDS researcher Robert Gallo today proposed using Africans to test the safety of potential AIDS vaccines before distributing in the United States. In a related story,
explicit the nature of social relations and the society in which they take place, and if described explicitly, will form a critique of those relations, even if it is not and has never been the intention of the pornographer. In her reading of the Marquis de Sade, Carter proposes two models of pornography. The first, outlined above, forms a critique indirectly. The second, and more rare, is a counterpractice of pornography, a, quote, moral pornography. Quote, the moral pornographer would be an artist who uses pornographic materials as part of the acceptance of the logic of a world of absolute sexual license for all genders and projects a model of the way such a world might work. A moral pornographer might use pornography as a critique of current relations between the sexes. She finds a challenge even within the excesses of de Sade. In the 18th century, he alludes to a radical path of revenge for women. Quote, he urges women to fuck as actively as they are able, so that powered by their enormous and hitherto untapped sexual energy, they will be able to fuck their way into history and in so doing change it. Fuck history. Pornography involves an abstraction of the human intercourse in which the self is reduced to its formal elements, the probe and the fringed hole. Quote, and that's Angela Carter, quote, to refuse and to yield, she murmured, how delightful. To pursue and to conquer, how august. To perceive and to reason, how sublime. Virginia Woolf, Rolando. Marlene collides the vernacular of the locker room and the syntax of the hot rod with the surface sheen of modernism. Her canvases, pillows, matchbooks, hot dogs, corn cobs, and bumper stickers speak in wagging tongues, from the crotch-grabbing bore to the hateful racist, a self-reflexive masquerade which leaps from insult to cliché, aphorism to joke. Grimy, tattered phrases slice and scrawl their way across the raw canvas surfaces to confront patriarchal power in at least two sites, where it thrives, in the banter of daily life, and where it lies in state, embalmed and stiff with rigor mortis, grafted onto the skin of quote-unquote post-painterly abstraction. Marlene's work taunts purist orthodoxies of male-dominated abstract modernism, a rude provocation to the somber works of Ad Reinhardt, the utopias of Barnett Newman, and, with the burning words of this show, the surfaces of Clifford Still. The roots in European modernism of the 20s and 30s, particularly the Bauhaus, Mondrian, and the Stil, these male masters promoted the values of an essential and pure space of art production, described effusively by critic Barbara Rose as, quote, forms stripped of all extravisual meaning, pure painting which rejects everything non-pictorial. Ironically, Max Kozloff praises the curved, cool virtues of Barnett Newman's work with an epithet which just as easily describes Marlene McCarthy's work. Quote, Newman habitually gives the impression of being out of control without being the least bit passionate. This chilly rage infused Moon Verkehr, Marlene's 1992 solo exhibition in Berlin. Moon Verkehr translates loosely as mouth traffic in German. It's a kind of slang for like slang talking. She brutally realized this notion in her piece called She Was Found Cut in Half with a Church Candle Up Her Joy Trail. An extremely skinny canvas, exactly Marlene McCarthy's height, the hateful language of a blaring headline here thrusts a weighty 8 inches off the wall. Combining the size queenery of Newman, canvases as thick as a porn star's dick, or the mute domestic stupidity of pillows, a subtle mockery of the art object's collectible, commodified status with a cacophony of enraged voices. Her works tap into societal and individual rage. Your mouth is bleeding like a cunt. Shoot a woman, save a job. You kill people to change their mind. Dreck schlampe, or abuse of power comes as no surprise. While openly acknowledging her debt to Jenny Holzer and other language-based artists, Marlene is restless with the pratfalls of flattering herself into submission by merely critiquing dominant culture. Rather, she yearns to turn the very vices of the rich into weapons to wound them with, to claim an authentic and aggressive sexualized voice for the female speaker. While revealing the hot rod as an iconic reservoir of male fantasy and a dumping ground for sexist privilege, promoted by advertising and the rituals of male bonding, Marlene pushes her work into mostly uncharted territory. Clit so big, don't need the hoe. Cunt wallow. You're my slut bottom suck, or I fucked Madonna, are hardly the refrain of an apologetic diplomat, Rather, Marlene intends to overturn the fixity of gendered language, biological essentialism, and the myth of squatting women birthing in the dust. Her urge for pleasure unzippers a lush and giddy zone of stimulation without procreation. Angela Carter reads the narrative style of the infamous story of O to reveal deliberate voyeurism, which, quote, ensures that the gap left in the text is just the right size for the reader to insert his prick into. Marlene deals with holes of different sort, part mirror, part linguistic prosthetics, yielding curves and hollows for readers behind crotch-fiddling men. She's had it. She won't take it anymore. Beds may be minefields, but language is still a battleground. The surplus of goods in the show nudges past fleshy arousal into the sublime and ecstatic. You better beg and whine and plead to be extinguished. You better bend over to become salvation. Trapped in the crack of these paintings, oblivion awaits. Beyond self and gender and religion and sex, pleasure, I've disappeared into you. So, I think we're probably at 5:30. We're almost there, so I'll talk for a minute before we break. So, I want to go back over a few of these pieces of work. I sort of talked about them through.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please do.
You mentioned 1820 as the rise in popular pornography. What I didn't quite catch it, what really made that possible? Or I mean, I understood the social movements, but why did that happen right there?
It had to do with mechanical reproduction, among other things. It had to do with, you know, prior to the 1820, pornography was basically only accessible to upper-class men. It was, you know, in etchings, engravings, before the invention of photography and drawings and the rest of it, it would be like in a library, you would find those kind of representations. Mm-hmm. If you go back to even the Renaissance in the 15th century, you find pornographic representations. 1820 corresponds with the democratization of press and the technology that allowed it to be, allowed work to be explicitly sort of disseminated, and immediately started eroding the kind of class dividing it, and also began to change, because you see by the end of the 19th century, women being involved as authors in erotic representation, which was previously unheard of. So there's a kind of explosion that happened in the 19th century. If you're looking for a source material on the work, this is the book of Angela Carter that's called The Sodian Woman, The Ideology of Pornography, which is on the syllabus I gave you, and I have this chapter, is a remarkable book. I think it's useful to reference that book, because it's, I think, in terms of my own work, particularly the feature film I'm going to talk about tomorrow, Savage Grace, Angela Carter is super relevant. There's a notion about trying, within my own work, about being interested to make sexual representations, not for a kind of titillating factor of arousing the audience, but instead to try to do what she's proposing. Is it possible to make, and the answer is, I don't know, because I don't think I did it, I don't think I succeeded, but is it possible to make a so-called moral pornography? Can you make a sexual representation that critiques sexual representation? We'll get more into this tomorrow, just one second. Like when I show Savage Grace, you know, the end of Savage Grace tells a story, it's based on a true story about a woman who sleeps with her son and develops over many years a kind of incestual sexual relationship with that son. And the climactic action of the film is a 20-minute scene where Julianne Moore has sex with her son, and it is a quite uncomfortable, excruciating scene. Directing and filming that scene was a really kind of powerful event on a personal level, to work with actors, to talk with actors, to get them to believe I'm doing what I'm doing. And it was really complicated what I was trying to do in that film, which was to try to take a kind of extreme action that we don't associate with humanity in any way. I mean, it's incest being probably the most extreme cultural and societal taboo, and try to look at that taboo and find within it human behavior, and try to understand moment by moment how the people get there, what happens.
Did you see Short Bus?
I did see Short Bus.
Did you think that was a sexual representation with moral implications?
I think that others were, I mean, to be completely and totally honest, because I'm friends with John Mitchell and all the rest of it, I think others were more enthusiastic about that film than I was. I found the film, I liked the kind of shed, you all know, Short Bus. It's the second feature of the director, John Cameron Mitchell, directed Hedwig and the Angry Inch. What I liked about it was its polymorphous, shaggy, sweet good-naturedness about the sex in it. I can't personally say I found the erotics very erotic in the film. Is it a critique? I don't know. I find the work more, I find that film more a celebration, a more open-hearted, big-spirited celebration of erotic representation. I think what I'm trying to get, I think I've just distinguished an approach. By distinguishing the work, I'm not trying to hierarchize and say I did a better job or did a different job. I think in terms of my own work, in terms of relationship to this trap of the notion of, is there such a thing as moral pornography? Is there a way to make sexual representation that is in and of itself embedding a kind of critique within it? I made an entire feature film predicated on exploring that question, and I got to the end of it, and the answer is, I don't know. Because I traveled the world with the film, and people responded, I've never made a piece of work that I've had this kind of reaction to. I mean, I had people be like, the film's a masterpiece, it's amazing, I think it's an incredible film, and I've had people say, hostily, intensely, I hate you for making this film, it's despicable, you're completely a vile human being. And, you know, the first couple experiences of that were a little bit sort of alarming, but after I could calm down on a personal level, it really heightened to me the kind of profound subjectivity around sexual representation. There is no neutral representation of the naked body in our culture. The naked body always comes to us framed by all kinds of social and cultural markers. And so the minute you put in it, and the interesting part is in Savage Grace, there's virtually no nakedness in the movie. There's a lot of sex, but everybody's wearing clothes. And that issue of, you know, so that my motivation in showing a scene that takes 20 minutes between mother and son having sex became called into question all the time. People saw it and said, that's obviously critique of incest. And there's no way you could see that scene as a celebration of what happens. It's destructive and punishing. While at the same time, there's a kind of odd mix of dispassion and objectivity in the way I shot the scene, but kind of intimacy in the behavior. You believe it. You're like, oh my God, that is what it would be like between a mother and a son. And that messy, unruly space of representation, for good, bad, right or wrong, was the motor that drove me in my work. And in a lot of ways, it's one of the reasons why I'm going to go back just quickly to the text-based work, and when we come back from the break, I'm going to show the second part briefly of Marlene's work. So, this first part of Marlene's work, I think, is interesting because she's playing with a kind of. So, I'll go all the way back to the beginning. Sorry. It's going too quickly. I'm pushing too fast. Sorry. Okay. So that's Marlene Olive's mugshot. This was the first piece that Marlene used and made with it, which is she took the actual mugshot and just tacked it on top of a guess ad and found the kind of juxtaposition of the body and the image kind of startling and peculiar. And from that, she began her drawings. These drawings, and so she made a number of drawings of Marlene Olive. This work is later. This work starts around 1996 or so and moves to the present. She's been making these kind of drawings for many years since. Prior to that time, this is a show that she had in Vienna. She made these kind of text-based works. They were raw canvas, unprimed canvas, and the way that she made them is she used very low budget. She went into a copy machine and had, on a copier, made those home ironing transfer devices so you can copy text and iron it on the canvas. And so she used women's work to make her painting. She ironed her paintings, and that was a huge part of the meaning, was that she wasn't doing something heroic and masculine like painting with a brush. She was ironing her paintings, which I thought was very witty and clever. And so first they're kind of taking some kind of the Gestilo and Bauhaus typography and using kind of, you know, slang language for female anatomy. They started growing. So each one of these little panels is 8.5 by 11. This is a huge canvas. This is like a 10-foot square canvas. Then she started, you know, thinking about a lot of the abstract expressions painters like Barnett Newman and Ad Reinhardt, who did minimalist line paintings. And instead of using graphic lines, she did text. The one that was bend over becomes salvation. And then she started exploring this kind of like hot rod tattoo style type. And this is I Fuck Madonna, Cunt Walla, Bed, Please Make Me Taste Like a Man. And using again all of this kind of, and you can see the affinity between Marlene's individual work and the kind of interest of Gran Fury. This idea of using pop cultural language to kind of uncover certain of the kind of hidden zones of language. Shoot a Woman, Save a Job is actually appropriate from a factory wall in Indiana. This was like graffiti when she was in the Indiana. She found this graffiti scribed on the factory wall, copied it, and replicated it into a piece of work. Peephole. And then she made a series of photographs of hot dogs, kind of wittily parodying the phallus. And so chic, immortal, each one has a different word. Okay, and I'll leave it there. And when we come back, I'll talk just a little bit more about the second part of Marlene's body of work. I'm going to talk about two other visual artists briefly, just to give a little more context. And then the last thing I'm going to do for the day is to show. show a compilation of short super 8 work I did that carries it from 1991 to 1999.
Are we going to watch that first?
Piece of material I talked about this afternoon is a relationship with the text of Angela Carter. If you don't know Angela, if you know that theoretical text, it's a fantastic text. I'd also encourage you, if you ever have time and interest, to look at Angela Carter's fiction. She's an extraordinary short story and novel writer. She's probably best known in terms of film terms that Neil Jordan made a film called The Company of Wolves, which is based on an Angela Carter short story. Sadly, I think there's a kind of treasure trove in that her fiction. I think there's an incredible body of work waiting to be made into narrative cinema, and no one's really tapped into it. She basically has written a lot of kind of mythological fairy tales, which take the kind of iconography of fairy tales and skew them slightly to get at the kind of gender politics or sexual politics underneath the underlying material. So the last thing I want to show for today is a compilation of short works that I made starting in 1991 and ending in 1999. She is titled Third Known Nest. Third Known Nest, if you want to get into the total arcaneness of my work, Third Known Nest is actually the name of the short film made by Nathan Leopold when he discovered a bird called the Kirkland Warbler. So in the film Swoon, I excerpt this little film that Nathan Leopold was one of the famous duo Leopold Loeb. He was a birder, and he discovered this rare bird called the Kirkland Warbler, and he found the third known nest of this Kirkland Warbler. And so I was so struck by that title, Third Known Nest, I appropriated it from my own work. I made most of these works in my 30s, so it was an idea of my third known nest, until someone later pointed out to me, but it's your fourth decade, you idiot. He's like, well, I made a series of short works, primarily shot in Super 8. I just want to read a very, very short text about this piece. It says, Third Known Nest is a collection of 9 short works completed approximately one each year from 1991 to 99. Interwoven by 9 quotations from some of my favorite writers, the 18 short entries in Third Known Nest function as an intimate visual diary, fractured pictures from my day-to-day life. I carry the Super 8 camera with me whenever and wherever I travel, and also at home, just running errands or in the garden. I shot nearly 150-foot rolls of film. I, in fact, have my Super 8 camera with me in Sospe, and I have my last rolls of Kodachrome. I don't know if you know, but Kodachrome has been eliminated. So the very last rolls of Kodachrome of my 25 years of shooting Super 8 film are going to probably be exposed in Sospe tomorrow or the day after. Okay. 6 of the pieces in Third Known Nest are shot on Super 8, 2 on 16mm, and 1 on mini-DV. With the exception of Nation, which is, you'll know when you see it, I edited them all on offline quarter-inch editing systems, meaning cuts only, in order to elaborate an intricate layered collage. Partially provoked by the video, each entry in the cycle of tapes pairs a literary touchstone with a song. They're somewhere in between the formal experimental film montage and the bombardment of our noisy pop culture. Though individual works are distinct in tone, the overwhelming impact of the program is emotional, nostalgic. Above all else, Third Known Nest works as a gallery of portraits and flux. Myself and the people I love, some living, some dead. As a counterpoint to feature films, these short films are pure liberation, a cheap, fast escape into the joys of the camera and the edit. No scripts, no production meetings, heaven. I've long admired the art of Dadaist Kurt Schwitters, his audio recordings of the Ursinata, and most of all, the visionary life-size Mertzbau collage, which eventually threatened to engulf his home. Like many others of his time, he remained a nomad after the war. I hope Third Known Nest shares something with Schwitter's graceful balancing of high art against low culture, beauty in the gutter, bumping up against the flotsam and jetsam of the clutter of the world. So, Liz.